Afternoon, everyone, and welcome to day two of the UT Dallas Women's Summit. My name is Dresden Goldberg, and I serve as the director for the Blackstone LaunchPad and Techstars Network at UT Dallas. We're so excited to welcome back all of our guests from day one and to see all of the new faces today joining us for today's session. Don't forget to check out the virtual booths and the networking options. I saw over 70 people tried it out yesterday. So I hope you all made some great new connections and learned some more about resources available to you. Today, we are going to hear from three founders who will share about their journeys and also answer your questions. To kick off our session for today, I would like to introduce you to a guest from our event sponsor, Atos. Please welcome Lisa Hochberg.
Hello, everyone. It is my pleasure to welcome you today as well. We're so glad you're here. I would like to thank UT Dallas for sponsoring this event. It's just been a great event so far. We look forward to hearing many inspirational stories today and as Justin said, also answering some questions. So I'm the Talent Acquisition Program Manager for Atos, and I focus a lot on campus recruitment. Atos is a global leader in digital transformation. We provide digital solutions to many well-known companies worldwide. We focus on cloud, cybersecurity, big data and analytics, business applications, and digital workplace. We are also the worldwide information technology partner for the Olympic and Paralympic Games. Because our North America headquarters is located in Irving, we have a strong relationship with UT Dallas and the UT System Universities. We've hired many of their talented students, not just in technology, but across our company. And every day I see the impact that students have made at our company. We love the fresh ideas that they bring. We love their energy. We love their passion. So it's just been great to work with all of them. And when Dresden asked us to sponsor this event in support of women, we were thrilled. And that's because as a company, we encourage the advancement of women. And we have a range of initiatives that we have to support women at all levels. Some of those initiatives include our Women Who Succeed program. And we have another one that I'd like to mention. It's our executive mentorship program, which prepares women to thrive in senior management roles. Also, in the spirit of innovation and to encourage students, we sponsor a global student competition. It's called the Atos IT Challenge. Its focus is on technology and innovation. One of the questions from yesterday was how a student can become an entrepreneur. They were asking for advice, and that's a great question. This contest, this type of contest, really provides that step into entrepreneurship. It fosters innovation. It teaches you how to start with an idea and then work through the steps to help develop that idea and to really bring it to life. UT Dallas made it to the finals in 2018, and we would love to see UT Dallas or a team from the UT system place in the top three again this year. This year's theme is decarbonization, how digital can decarbonize non-digital. So think about that one. It's a great topic. To learn more about this year's competition, go to atositchallenge.net. That's atositchallenge, one word, .net. Students enter in small teams. It's free to enter. You can win prize money. You only need an idea to register, and the first deadline is November 30th. We welcome all of you to participate. We look forward to seeing your ideas. This is just one way that Atos helps empower the next generation to see what they can achieve. Now it is my pleasure to introduce you to the moderator of today's Founder Stories, Jenny Anchondo. Jenny is an Emmy award-winning news anchor, host, and reporter. She has worked for CBS, NBC, and Fox at stations all over the country. Jenny is the co-host of Morning After on CW33. She's an executive producer and co-host of the Second Shot podcast. This is an inspirational and motivational show. It takes a second shot at the news of the day. Jenny works as a media coach and a mentor to individuals and businesses looking to gain confidence to effectively get their message across on camera. She is a passionate volunteer and advocate for important causes. She and her husband, Heath, are parents to a daughter. Please welcome Jenny Anchondo.
Lisa, thank you. Oh my gosh, good to see you and good to see everybody virtually. This is so much fun. Let me get all squared up here. I'm my own studio crew. Oh my gosh, I am thrilled to be here. Like Lisa said, I was here last year and I actually, we just got off the air this morning. I host a daily show at 10 a.m. on CW33, which is where I'm coming to you from today because it's kind of in the middle of the workday. And we were able to do an interview about this very event and just get people excited about it because this is really a beautiful thing. And thank you also for the Second Shot podcast shout out. We are more than 200 episodes in. So if you're looking for something that is along the lines of inspiration and motivation, that is where we're at. I worked for almost two decades in traditional news, and now I'm really focused on stories that uplift, inspire, and motivate. So that's part of what we're doing today. And listen, enough about me. Let's get into our guests today. This first guest is somebody who we would call a good get in the business world of news, a very, very good get. We are going to talk to three very inspiring entrepreneurs. And like I said, this is the name of my game. We can't often get inspiration just from ourselves. We have to sometimes see it in order to see it in ourselves. And so the first of the ladies we're going to be interviewing today is Sana Saleh, who is the founder of Lala Hijabs. And I will welcome her in. Well, or actually,
before I welcome her in, let me tell you a little bit about her, because sometimes it's a little awkward to just sit there while someone's talking about you. So she is the wife and mother of two. She lives in Toronto, Canada. She owns two businesses and started her entrepreneurial journey after she had her first child at 25 years old. So she was a very young entrepreneur. She's also pretty much killing the social media game. And as we all know, that's a big part of marketing right now. It's a big part of connecting to the audiences, especially in this virtual world that we're in. So she has an audience of 500,000 followers on social media, and she is expanding her business every single day. Her vision is to bring empowerment and confidence to women and families all over the world, and she's doing it beautiful. So please welcome Sana Saleh. Hey, Sana.
Hello.
So great to see you. Oh my gosh, I have so many questions for you. I've just been dying to dive into this, but I want to remind everybody before I go, if you're at home thinking, or at work or wherever you're watching this, thinking, I've got a question for Sana too, hold on to them, because we are going to do an open forum at the end of all of these interviews. So first of all, let's just hear a little bit about you and your business and what it is that you provide to the world.
Oh my gosh, awesome. Okay, so I'm now 29 years old. So I started my first business when I was 25 after I had my baby. I actually went to school for something completely different. I was a social worker. So completely the opposite of being an entrepreneur. And then I had my first child and things just kind of changed for me. I think my mindset changed a little bit and I just really wanted to do something different and find a different path. And I feel like social work is very, you know, focused on empowerment anyway. And I feel like I'm just empowering people in a different way. Now I just make them feel better about themselves. I boost confidence. I boost self-esteem. It's just super awesome. So the two businesses I have now, one, I have a beauty business, and the second, I have this awesome headscarf company that me and my husband started during quarantine out of all times to start a business. And it has been wildly successful. So I'm really excited to share all the things.
It looks like it's been wildly successful. And it's interesting because part of that interview we did this morning on CW, we did it with one of the sponsors, Capital One. And I was saying, you know, there's so many women right now who had planned to start a business and they've put it on hold. We don't know how long the pandemic's going to go for, obviously. I wish we knew something definitive. Can you talk a little bit about how you did launch that company for somebody who's thinking, gosh, you know, I've got all the plans, but I'm not sure if this is the right time?
Mm-hmm. So our story is actually probably going to be motivating to most people because we didn't even have the foresight of starting this hijab company at all, like at all this year. My husband, due to COVID-19, was actually laid off. He by trade is an aircraft engineer. So you can probably imagine how hard hit the aircraft industry is. It is brutal. Nobody that he worked with is back to work yet. It is pretty insane here. So he was laid off, and then my beauty business is the only thing that was sustaining us at that time. At the same time, we started creating content on TikTok. This goes hand in hand. I have to mention that because that took a lot of part in like the vision and the inspiration for Lala Hijabs. So we basically had some savings from his career, like from his job, despite being laid off and everything. And we sat down together one day, and I think everybody during quarantine was tie-dyeing stuff anyway. I feel like everybody just got really bored. Right. Yeah. Like everybody really got bored. And I had a white headscarf at home and I tie-dyed it just for fun because we were bored. And people started asking me on TikTok, like, where'd you get that headscarf from? And I was like, oh, I did it myself. And then me and my husband sat down. We're like, wait a second. People are asking about this. Like, maybe there's a demand for this. So that's when we took our savings and we're like, let's just do it. Let's just go head first and just see if this works. And it's been insanely successful. It's been really, really awesome.
Wow. So you really saw the need, and instead of mulling it over for the next 3 years,
we just did it. We took the risk and just did it.
What did you learn in that process of just doing it? Is there anything that you would have changed or done differently so far? I know it's been a short amount of time.
Yeah. Well, so we officially launched the business August 25th. So it's been about almost 2 months. Mm-hmm. And I would say we took about 3 months to kind of perfect it and mull it over. Like we did do a lot of trials. We did a lot of samples. We had a lot of failures. So I want people to know that are like listening to this, if you think you have to be perfect from the get-go, it's never going to work out that way. It's just never going to work out that way. You're going to have failures. You're going to have things that kind of set you back a little bit and upset you, but you have to work through those things in order to get to the top and in order to do what it is that you want to do. And that's what we went through. Like, we went through some things that really did set us back and really did hurt my feelings. Like, maybe this isn't actually going to work out, or, you know, this is harder than I thought, finding the perfect fabric and finding a manufacturer and just doing everything. There's so much that's involved. And I think we had that vision and we knew we wanted to get there. So we just made it happen. Like, we just made it happen.
Let's talk about hurt feelings for a second. I'm somebody who's very, very sensitive, and my business is very, it's not great for sensitive people. It's very, you know, cutthroat and can be really harsh. I think the hard thing is that sometimes being sensitive is what allows you to see the business idea. It's what allows you to see other people. So how did you develop a thick skin during this short and tough process?
Mm-hmm. So my husband, it's really good because my husband is really, when he sees something and he wants to do it, he'll just do it. Like, he doesn't care about feelings, like nothing bothers him. If he fails at something, he'll just do it again. Whereas like me, I'm a little bit of the opposite. I'm a little more emotional. I'm like, you know what? Maybe this isn't going to work. Like, I'm struggling. I'm overwhelmed. This is a lot harder than I thought. Maybe we need help, but we can't afford the help, and just so many different things. And I feel like he really like pulled me in the right direction and was like, let's focus. Like, this is what we want to do. We need to make this happen. Let's try again. And that happened a few times. Like, that, we went through that process maybe like 4 or 5 different times till we got to the place where we were like, okay, like I think we are ready to launch this now.
It sounds like you two are a really good team. And sometimes that happens, mm-hmm. sometimes it doesn't. I guess you have to try it out to see. I know that you've really made this effort to make the company sustainable. Mm-hmm. Talk about how you've done that and why it's a priority.
Mm-hmm. So I personally started wearing the headscarf about 7 to 8 years ago. And when I started wearing it, I did a massive haul from like every big hijab company in the world. And every single time I would purchase hijabs, I wouldn't just purchase like one or two. I would purchase like 10 at a time because I really wanted to build my collection. And every single time, every single one came in a plastic bag. And it kind of drove me crazy. Like, I would pull all of the hijabs out and I would have this huge stack of just like plastic bags, and I would have to throw them in the garbage. And at that point, like, I never really had a vision for starting my own company, but I knew in my mind that there was something wrong with that vision. There was just something wrong with that. And so when we started, with our manufacturer, we initially did our first batch, our first run, and hundreds came in these plastic bags. And I didn't even think at first to tell them not to do that. And we learned our lesson after that time. They basically told us, they said, we don't do that. Like, we don't just send out stuff without putting it in plastic bags. And we were like, well, this needs to happen, or we're not going to work with your factory. Like, it's just not going to happen. We don't want plastic. We don't want excess waste. We want to hand package everything ourselves. So me and my husband, every time we get an order, we package it in tissue paper. We package it in compostable mailers. We have zero plastic, zero in our packaging, which is kind of insane. And it is a little bit more on the expensive side in terms of packaging, but you really have to think about what impact that's going to be making and how that's going to look for people that are the consumer ultimately.
Yeah, I think part of that is education too. I think once people understand the mm-hmm. value that it provides long term for us, for our children, you know, for our earth, for so many different things, mm-hmm. I think people are willing to pay a little bit more for something like that. But it does, education comes on the front end because we just don't think about it. So much stuff does just come in plastic. And unless mm-hmm. you ask for it to not, or unless you specifically say, I'm going to order from this company, because they're sustainable, well, then you're not going to be able to go there. I am curious how'd you grow your social media following? How'd you get into that business?
Oh my goodness. Again, quarantine. So me and my husband started TikTok in February of this year. And we are almost at 550,000 followers, which is crazy. And we're nothing special. We're nothing special. We just share our life. We're funny. We educate people. And I really feel like that in itself, just having people connect with you on a different level, is truly what makes people connected. Like, they feel like they know us. They feel like they're family. We're not selling to them. You'll never find us like our videos of us where we're just like selling to people. We never do that. We just like to build a genuine connection. And I really feel like that is what has grown all of our platforms, whether it's the Lala Hijabs accounts, the Instagram accounts, our business website, ultimately. And we can see where people come from, like on our back end of our website, we can see where they're coming from. And social media is our biggest driver for our business. Like 95% of it is driven from social media.
I can only imagine. Yeah, mm-hmm. I'm sure. So it was funny when I was preparing for this interview, I was, of course, you know, during COVID with my daughter. We have a 3-year-old, 3.5-year-old. So she's with me all the time. And I showed her, you know, this is who mommy's interviewing. And she saw you and goes, "Mommy, you're interviewing a princess?"
Oh my gosh. That is so sweet.
I think I am. So I want to talk about the beauty business. What's the other aspect of this? Because 3-year-olds in Dallas, Texas, you are the princess.
That is so sweet. So my beauty business is a direct sales company that I have been with for 4 years. And that was a great entry level for me because I really feel like it prepared me for ultimately owning my own everything, like my own business. I don't have to worry about manufacturing the products. I just do the marketing aspect of it. And I love it. I love helping women build a routine. Like me too. Like I have a 3-year-old and I have a 5-year-old. So I'm a busy mom too. Like I don't have time to like do the things I could do before. And so my biggest thing is teaching women how to do beauty routines that are quick, easy. You can have a baby on your shoulder. You can be feeding a baby, nursing a baby, doing whatever you need to do and still feel beautiful.
Yes, that is essential. Oh my gosh, Mandy, who's coming up, has a 3- and a 5-year-old as well. Like we got to get all of our, when all this is over, we got to get all of our 3-year-olds together.
I love it.
What do you think are some of the key income generating activities that you have done to really get out there? Because it's one thing to get a following. It's another thing to translate that into sales, which it sounds like you've done. So talk about if somebody's short on time, busy mom, busy student, you know, busy working at a corporate job, but also doing this side business. What are the key income generators?
So I'm a huge fan of time blocking for content creation. I feel like content creation is truly like the meat and bones of our business. So whether that is photo shoots to promote your product, whether it's videos, tutorials showing how to use your product, have like even compiling a list of reviews from people that have tried your product, anything to do with showing people what you're all about, what makes you different, what makes you stand out. And I always time block at least once a week, even if it's like 2 hours, and I'll bang out all of that stuff for the whole week. Like you don't have to dedicate too much time to it, but make sure that you always have some form of content going out every single day. And I know that sounds like a lot of content, but like I said, like I time block. So once a week, I'll take, you know, a little bit of time to create some content and then I'll pump it out for the rest of the week.
That's a great tip. It can be very overwhelming, even for people who are like, look, they're not trying to become a TikTok star, but they have a business or they're trying to start their business. And it almost can feel this pull of like, I want to work in the business, but I'm like trying to put out this, be my own marketer and stuff.
Yes. Yeah, exactly. Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
Okay. What has been your biggest source of inspiration? Where do you get the inspiration from to keep going, to keep creating?
Mm-hmm. Oh my gosh. My kids, my children, like quarantine has brought us together. My husband was laid off. My kids are being homeschooled now. Life has really changed. And ultimately it's our kids. Like we just want to create something that'll be long-term, something very sustainable that maybe we can be able to pass down to them. That's ultimately our vision and our inspiration is building something special that we can then pass down to our kids.
And you're a very young entrepreneur. A lot of people who are watching this are college students right now who would love to be where you are. What's your best piece of advice for a college student who aspires to become an entrepreneur?
Ooh, find something in the market that requires a solution. So find something that's missing. Find a piece that nobody is doing. Find something that people have always thought about doing but have never actually done it. For us, it's hand dyeing hijabs. It sounds simple, but no one is doing it. No one takes that extra time. No one wants to spend time tie dyeing one hijab, two hijabs, 50, 60, 100. And there was a need for it. No one was doing it. So we saw that need and we took it and we provided the solution and and here we are. So if you feel like there's some kind of gap in the market, try to fill that gap and you'll see that there's going to be a niche market for it.
It's so true. I like that example because sometimes we think so big, we think we are like, oh gosh, all the problems are solved, but there's something mm-hmm. very specific. And it's so true. You caught on at the exact right time. Brighton mm-hmm. and I tied some dye-dyed some soccer shorts and everything like that. But listen, yours gives the princess vibe. So what is the next step for your company? What can we look forward to?
So right now we're offering worldwide shipping, but I would personally love to have distributors in every major country. So global expansion is ultimately our goal in order to kind of just have faster shipping for customers, have, you know, faster access to our customers. I think it's going to be a global expansion. That's our next step.
Sana, I cannot wait to see the global expansion. This is very exciting. I hope that some of the people watching could see a little bit of themselves in you. Mm-hmm. Thank you. This has really been a gift. I appreciate it.
Thank you.
So Sana's going to hang out in the backstage area. This is fun. This is how we do virtual events now, you guys. She's going to hang out in the backstage area. So if there was something and you're like, Jenny, why didn't you ask this? Hold your question until the end because you are going to get to ask it at the end. So so hang on to that and be thinking of some questions that you'd like to ask at the end when we do the Q&A. Okay, we have another good get here. The next interview is with Mandy Price. She is an advocate for diversity, equity, and inclusion. She is also the CEO and co-founder of Kanarys, which is an online platform for individual contributors to anonymously rate, review, and submit surveys on diversity and inclusion at their current and former employers. Talk about something that needed to be created, right? Kanarys has been covered by Forbes, CNBC, Afrotech, Business Insider, and HR.com. They were also actually recently asked to join in on the Google for Startups Accelerator Black Founders class. Mandy is no slouch. She has earned her doctorate from Harvard Law School. She also has her MBA from UT Austin. She lives in Dallas with her husband and two children. Let's welcome in Mandy Price. You can do the virtual applause from home. Hey, Mandy, good to see you.
I'm doing well. How are you?
I am great. I am very excited to get into this conversation. So go ahead, and I gave a little bit of an intro about your business, but nobody can say it better than you. So talk about really the void that your business fills and what you provide for people and companies.
Yeah, Jenny, so you did a great job. I would say when we think about Kanarys, it's the first of its kind technology platform that's really built on fostering collaboration between employees and employers. A lot of times it's difficult to discuss diversity, equity, inclusion issues when we're talking about issues of race or gender, religion, sexuality. Those are difficult things for people to talk about in the workplace, but we know that these things about our identity do affect our work environment. And people with underrepresented backgrounds have different experiences in the workplace. So we really wanted to put together a platform where not only could people learn about the experiences of other underrepresented professionals in the workplace, but also provide insights into the actual environment of that workplace. We're tracking information on over 1,000 different companies right now. And so you can look at detailed information like, do they provide transgender inclusive insurance? Do they recruit at HBCUs and Hispanic serving institutions? What are their policies on fertility treatments or surrogacy? So we really provide a deep dive, but we also allow employees to leave anonymous feedback and reviews. And we distill down those insights and provide feedback for companies in a way that's safe for employees so that they don't have any retaliation, any negative career ramifications. So companies know exactly what they need to change about their workplace in order to make it better. I think, you know, my perspective as not only as a woman of color in the workplace, but then also helping to drive my law firm's diversity, equity, inclusion initiatives. I knew how important it was for employees to speak up, but I knew how challenging that was, especially when you're the only. So that's really where the genesis came from, and really being able to equip companies with the data, research, and benchmarking that they need to drive diversity, equity, inclusion like they do any other business priority. Mm-hmm. I was frustrated because I felt that, when we looked at any other business imperative, there were all kind of KPIs, benchmarks. If those goals weren't met, there were consequences. And I felt for diversity, equity, inclusion, we kind of, you know, were regulated. Sorry, I'm getting tongue-tied there, to more celebrations, right? That's how the approach that many organizations were taking is, okay, they supported diversity, equity, inclusion, but really it was often in the form of celebrating Black History Month or Pride Month, those kind of things, and really thought that our focus should be that, but more and more. We should also be looking at, are we ensuring that people are being paid fairly, that they have the same opportunities and access to good work and promotional opportunities. And so really looking at some of the systemic and institutional inequities that we see within the workplace. So we wanted to create dashboards and benchmarks and metrics so company could really drive diversity, equity, inclusion with that same rigor and business analysis that they do with every other business priority.
Okay, so let's talk about this. Was there any one instance that made you think, wait a minute, this business doesn't exist? Was there a light bulb moment, Mandy, where you said, I've got to figure this out because I need to file a report, or I want to let other people know about this, and there's no platform to do so?
So we started Kanarys in 2018 because we knew data and accountability was paramount to solving diversity and inclusion issues. I had many experiences in my career, but I can't necessarily point to one because my experiences are very similar to many other underrepresented professionals in the workplace. You know, when I was in the workplace, I had someone in leadership ask me if I got into Harvard legitimately. I was referred to as the firm's diverse partner in a meeting. And so, like I said, I have my share of incidences, but those weren't necessarily the light bulb moments. It was more the fact that those incidences were so normal, and they're so normal for so many of us. And when you look at some of the statistics, right, 57% of African Americans, Black employees, say that they experience some form of discrimination when it comes to pay or promotional opportunities in the workplace. When we look at women of color, 60% say that they feel on guard daily at work. So the experiences that I had are the experiences that so many people in our country have. And so when we think about kind of those motivations, the motivations were, how do we build this bridge so that we can make the workplace that we all want? I truly believe that companies want to have workplaces where people do feel included, because we know that when people feel included, that the work environment is better, there's better financial performance, there's lower absenteeism, there's better engagement. So not only is it better for employees, it's better for companies as well. But there's, go ahead,
James. Sorry, we're in this virtual thing. It's hard to, I want to make sure that we get to some of the questions about entrepreneurship. So I would love to hear, and clearly you've got a solid background to be able to speak on this, and you saw a need. What did the actual, so you have the idea, but what did the actual starting of the business look like? I mean, do you call a web developer? Like, take us through those steps really quickly and what that looked like to tangibly start the business.
So my first steps were recruiting my co-founders. And so one of my co-founders is my husband. So that may seem easy.
No, it's not.
But saying to your husband, I'm going to quit my job, and I think you should too, and let's start this company, especially when, as you noted, we had at that time a 3-year-old and a 1-year-old. Mm-hmm. It took a little bit of convincing, but he came on board fairly quickly. You know, anyone who's going into entrepreneurship knows that it's very difficult, especially those first few years, and that you have to be prepared not to bring in income, right? Most entrepreneurs can't pay themselves for at least the first year. And in our case, it was around 19 months before we could pay ourselves. And so that was kind of how it started. And then other than my husband, who's one of the co-founders, Star Carter, is one of the other co-founders. And so I was able to recruit Star because we had, all three of us had actually gone to UT Austin together. But Star and I had maintained a relationship. We actually went to law school together and then worked at the same law firm together. And so we had kept in contact over the years, and she had experienced a lot of the same things that I had, as far as the challenges, kind of speaking as the issues of moms. She had taken two maternity leaves and was told that she wasn't going to be promoted to partner because she had taken those maternity leaves. So she was very aware of the challenges that women and other underrepresented groups face in the workplace. And so we were really, really motivated to solve that. So after recruiting those co-founders, the next step was recruiting our advisory board. So we were really fortunate and able to recruit a stellar advisory board, chief diversity officers from companies like Pepsi and Coca-Cola, being able to get other experts in not only technology, but as well as finance and marketing. And so we slowly built together the team that we felt we needed to ensure our business was successful. And then we started to get team members on board as well. And so the first kind of expert we got was a DI expert, someone that had built DI programs for Fortune 500 companies, had been in the field for decades. And then we actually, one of our first employees was a UTD alumnus. We had actually gone to, speaking at the Enrich Her conference, and was able to meet someone that was getting their master's in business analytics at UTD. And so she joined our team as an intern and is still with us 2.5 years later as a full-time employee and one of our most senior members and a senior data analyst on our team. So it's slow, right? It's not something with entrepreneurship that comes together overnight. It's really methodical. And I think with entrepreneurship, not only have to you have that tenacity and be prepared for, a lot of people call it you're building the plane while you're flying it, which is definitely, I think, a great analogy. But that even as much as you plan, things are not going to go according to plan. So that unpredictability is a part of entrepreneurship.
So let's talk about, in the most basic sense, how you pay for something like this. So you say, you know, okay, you have to be prepared not to draw an income. What does that look like? Does that look like you pull from your 401k? Does that look like you've been saving up and planning for this? Does this look like angel investors? Does this look like a loan from the bank? Like, can you get real about how you pay for something like this?
Yeah, so it's tremendously difficult for startups to get loans. So that is usually never an option. For us, what it looked like was we pulling money from our 401ks, pulling money from our savings. Luckily, we had worked for, you know, over a decade. So we had some money stored up. But I do think anyone who's looking to go into entrepreneurship needs to have a financial safety net, because money is tight in the early days. It takes a while to, especially if you're building any kind of technology product, or not even technology, right? Any consumer good or product, hardware products, all that takes a lot of financial capital. And so you have to really have money set aside. I know a lot of people that will continue to work in their day jobs while they kind of on the side have some people call it the side hustle with their entrepreneurship. And so I encourage you to do that. But sometimes it's difficult, especially when you get to a certain stage of your business, to continue to operate in full-time capacity in a day job, especially when you're starting to look for third-party funding. You typically cannot get funding from angels or VCs, venture capitalists, if you are not working on your venture full-time. So I think that's something that's important. And, you know, a lot of the things that people typically go to if they're not using their own funds is using funds from friends and family. But for a lot of people, that's not an option, right? Their friends and family don't have the financial capability.
Friends and family are like, go! Let's go for it.
Right, right. And so I think, like you said, Jenny, all of our families are willing to support us emotionally, which is needed as well in entrepreneurship. I mean, there's many, many sleepless nights. And so, but I would say when you're going into this, to not lose sight of your vision in your mission, because it is so difficult. And so I think one of the things that is one of the most important characteristics of an entrepreneur is that tenacity and grit. You have to make a way out of no way. And so I think you have to realize that things may seem impossible at times, but you have to keep your vision and mission at the top of your mind, and you'll be able to figure it out and reach that turning point.
Yeah, I understand you recently closed a significant funding round. So what advice do you have for women who are raising funds, who friends and family are doing this, but not, you know, investing? Give us some hot tips for that.
So there is a huge funding disparity between women within venture capital. I believe 2% of venture capital funding goes to women. When we look at women of color, the funding disparities are even more bleak. 0.06% of funding goes to Black women. Star and I are very fortunate. We're one of 50 Black women that have raised over $1 million. But that's also horrendous, right? That there's only been 50 Black women within the US. And that's not this year. We're talking about in totality of VC funding that have ever raised over $1 million. So I want people to realize that. And one of the things that we did once we, especially because our platform is all about how do we reduce disparities in corporate America. So then we kind of go into the VC entrepreneur space and see these same disparities. And what we realize is that a lot of women are asked different questions, right? There's been all this research as far as women being asked more prevention-based questions as opposed to promotion-based questions. And so what we do when we're in meetings with angels or VCs is turn that around. And what I mean by prevention-based questions, women are asked more questions based off of risk, where they're having to show kind of how they're going to overcome various obstacles. Where in meetings with men, the research has shown that men are asked more promotion questions that allows them to talk about their market opportunity, things as far as the potential of the business. And so when we see that we're getting these prevention and risk-based questions, we turn them around into those promotion-based answers so that when we can show the opportunities that our business actually has. So I think it's important to be aware of that. And to be prepared for those types of questions so that you can turn your responses around into those promotion-based methods.
That's really good. It's it's like the business version of when a journalist is interviewing a politician. Listen, you just put out there what you want your audience to hear. And I think that's a beautiful example for women that the statistics you cited are pretty disturbing. I think probably everybody in this group knew that, women were going an uphill battle on this, but wow, that is significant. What has been the hardest part of starting Kanarys?
There's been many hard things, but I would say the funding is one of the most difficult because I think everyone knows it's hard to grow and scale a business if you don't have funding. We've been extremely successful in recruiting great talent, right? That's usually some of the things that people have a hard time. And same as with our advisory board. I think people knew the importance of what we were doing and the fact that there wasn't really true data. You know, when we talk about that we're tracking objective data on over 1,000 companies, people just weren't doing that. They weren't looking at things that we were looking at as far as what is the EO1s on this company and how does this company really compare to others when we're looking at all these objective DEI factors. So I think our advisors and our team and all of that, because they had lived these experiences, understood the importance. But when we really started to talk with venture capitalists, sometimes they weren't as bought in. I think it's very different now, right? Because of the racial awakening that the country has had since June. And so I think people have seen all the pledges for companies that have come out and pledging not only, address the racial inequities that exist, but pledging just renewed commitment to diversity, equity, inclusion overall. But 2.5 years ago when we started the company, there wasn't that kind of market validation. So we had VCs coming to us saying, do you really think that women and people of color have a different experience in the workplace? And so just the problem itself is something that we had to prove. And so I think, we've seen that turnaround, and that kind of goes to what I was saying earlier, as far as you have to believe in your mission and vision and stick it through. I think that's one of the things too, where people say the importance of having underrepresented voices in the VC space, because, you know, women and people of color and LGBT and these different groups know that their experiences are different in the workplace. And so that's why we have to have people that understand the problems that can also be able to fund the solutions for these underrepresented communities.
Yeah, Mandy, that, I mean, gosh, I see the strength that you had to have had in the years leading up to this year, where all of a sudden people realize the things that a lot of other people really knew existed. So thank you for sharing your story. I can imagine there are a lot of other questions that people had that we didn't get to. So you guys hold on to those questions or even type them in the chat. And then we will ask Mandy when we do the Q&A at the end. Mandy Price, thank you so much.
Thank you.
And congratulations. What a company, right? What a desperately needed company. All right, the next guest, third round of interviews. Here we go. Ugh, I could talk to all these ladies all day, truly, if we had the time, but I want to keep everybody on task because I know that you are busy women. So my third and final interview today is with Katie Anderson. So Katie is the CEO and founder of Save Water Company and Save Watts Company. Her vision and her impact have garnered recognition by Forbes magazine as one of the Forbes 30 under 30 game changers is in energy. She has also gone on to work in the entrepreneurship world. Her creativity even expands into poetry and storytelling under her alias, The Luckiest Woman. So I'm excited to talk about that too. So whether it's swimming with whales off the coast of Tonga or racing horses across the Egyptian desert, her internal explorer seeks the full breadth experience of life. Doesn't Katie sound like fun? Let's welcome her in. Hi, Katie.
Hi.
Good to see you. I'm so glad that you are here. So I gave a little bit of a brief intro on yourself, your business is, but why don't you tell us really what these businesses are all about and the service that they provide?
Yeah, sure. So Save Water Co. is our oldest company. It's roughly 6.5 years old. And we do water conservation in the apartment industry. So essentially what we do is analyze water usage and identify areas that we can decrease the water consumption, typically by replacement of toilets, showers, fixing drips, leaks, any kind of water inefficiencies that are going on in the properties. And then we monitor that long term. So Save Watts Co. is a brother company, if you will, doing the same thought process, but with the energy side. And Save Watts Co. is roughly 1.5 years old. So Save Watts Co. really came from us servicing the water side and our clients steadily asking us about energy. And so eventually we just said yes to it.
Okay, so what's the backstory? I have to know what made you think, okay, let's solve the water problem specifically for apartments.
Yeah, you know, so apartments, you know, what's fun about them is the consumption to actual impact is very high. So you would live in an apartment unit, I would live in an apartment unit. The average number of units inside of one apartment complex is roughly 200. So by getting the answer yes from an owner, I can impact 200 homes by entering one driveway. So that's sort of our thought process. We get asked often about single families and other types of real estate. And the reason we started with apartments was because of the impact level. I mean, these apartment complexes are using 2-3 million gallons of water a month, sometimes double, triple that amount. So our average savings is 50 to 60%. So when I take that and once we do it, it happens every month from that point forward. So if a property is using 5 million gallons of water a month and I save 2.5 million gallons by going on in a week, and it does that every single month from that point forward, it's big savings with the most efficient use of time.
Okay. And what about you said, I'm going to enter the water world. I'm, you know, I care about this as a young woman, really understanding the problem back when you started.
Yeah. You know, I was one of the first to go to school in my family and was pre-med. So my intention was to become a doctor. And about my junior year, I started feeling the, I don't know about this path for me. Mm-hmm. I couldn't actually at the time imagine going to school for that much longer. and so I really turned to books and I read a book called Think and Grow Rich by Napoleon Hill.
Yes, I read it. Very good.
Yeah, very old book. So that book introduced the word entrepreneur to me. And at the time, I had never heard that word. I had no idea what an entrepreneur was. But after I read it, I sort of, this seed was planted in my head, which was essentially, I can create whatever life I want. Like, that's a possibility. I don't have to follow one of these setup structures that society's teaching me. I can just create. Like, are you kidding? Like, this idea was just mind-blowing to me. And it sounded way better than going to school much longer. So I'd say that's when the seed was planted. And through reading the books, I got into real estate and became a commercial real estate appraiser first at a school. And that's where I really learned about the financial side of real estate. And then steadily got into the water conservation industry within real estate. And long story short, I was having dinner with a friend and I was feeling very unhappy in my current job. I was a salesperson and making extremely good money. I could travel. I could do all of these things that I would say, even still to this day, society says, this is the life to live, you know, make good money, travel, have your time. But I was feeling so unhappy. And that was bothersome to me. I mean, here I was very young and living this life. And what do you mean I'm still unhappy? What's wrong with me? At the time is what I was thinking. And that's when I really discovered that an integral part of my being here on this planet is my creativity. And in my current job, I kept getting stifled. So I would go to the table with ideas. What about this? What about this? And kept getting told no by these guys. So I just, after a while, I just thought, you know, this isn't worth it. This is not worth it to me. The money, the time, the freedom, all of that's not worth it. I have to be able to move on these knowings that are inside of me. I have to be able to create them. And so a friend asked me if I would be, what was I interested in? I said, you know, I have my own ideas about water. I can see it. And he said, why don't you start your water company? And that was sort of the face in the mirror moment of like, you know, here's all of these options. Here's I sort of saw the worst case scenario. I just go belly up, embarrass myself, you know, X, Y, Z I could come up with. And then, you know, this side, it's like become very successful. And I say that the moment I became okay with all potential possibilities was the moment that I was brave enough to move forward with it. So I just went for it.
Like that, say you fail, you know, that's a word with different definitions for different people, but say it doesn't work, you lose all the money, you know, the family says you should have stuck with pre-med. You got to a point where you were okay with that. And that's when you knew you were ready to handle it.
I centered that inside of me and I became okay with me. It wasn't even about like, oh, well, I'll go make sure it's okay with this person. It was me to me. Hey, internal conversation here. This is our worst case scenario. Will we be okay with me? Like, are we going to be okay through the worst case? And it was when I came home to that I was unstoppable. It's like, yep, let's do it. Like, I'm already okay with my worst case. Let's go for it.
Yeah, that's really hard because the thing is that so many people really struggle to even find out who they are. So then it's even harder to figure out, first of all, who am I? Second of all, what do I actually want and what am I actually okay with? So are you someone who was born knowing yourself or was that a process?
Are you kidding? The mystery of life and existence? That's a daily learning curve. I just say entrepreneurship just turned the dial big time on that. So I started getting fire hydrant doses of what it means to be me. Who am I? Those questions you just asked. I mean, you want to talk about like throwing curveballs. They almost happen every day. I mean, there was no way to prepare for this journey. And in the same part, what a gift. I would say that the moment that I started looking at the business as a reflection of me, so that I could then ask myself those questions, everything changed. So when I started my business, it was very much like, I'm going to be a businesswoman. I'm going to make money. I'm going to grow this to XYZ. It's all about the impact. It's all about, and some of those are still absolutely true to this day. I would say that the gifts of entrepreneurship truly started sinking in when I flipped the question to like, who am I now? Like when something new would happen that was just completely left field, it's like, who am I now? Who am I now? And that includes the people that I surround myself with. So I was thinking about this as I was driving to where I am right now, which is Taos, New Mexico. And I thought, you know, one of the greatest gifts I ever gave myself through entrepreneurship was working with people that I love. So in my old job, I used to just get frustrated because I felt like I was forced to work with whoever I was working with. And then you just do whatever you got to do to like get along with this person. And I used to say, like, one of the reasons I want to start and create my own thing is so that I can then work with people that I really love, that I really, it's like, if I'm going to spend 40 hours a week, why on earth would I ever use my time with anyone else other than someone that I would enjoy spending time with outside of the working business? Because what I've learned is, like, 2020, when stuff like this happens, the people that I get to look at and lean on and cry with and make decisions with and, like, heart filling. And that to me has been, you know, aside from the success, the awards, the money, one of the gifts that Save Water Co. has given me is I didn't even know that this was possible.
Yeah, that's awesome. So you guys, she's traveling the US. She kind of like slipped by that part, but I want to hit that home. She's traveling the US in a van right now. She's in Taos. So what is, so we know what your prior success sort of definition was. What is your success definition now?
Oh man. You know, I think it almost defines itself daily. I'd say that one of the other gifts I gave myself was releasing attachment to any set definition of anything. So I redefine success for myself sometimes morning to the afternoon, because who knows what's going to happen. And I would say that the, you know, right now with where I am in my life, the ultimate success for me would be to honor me and where I am. A big part of my learning journey within entrepreneurship has been very much out of balance in serving others and learning how to bring that same attention back to myself and honoring that I'm a moving, living, dynamic human. I mean, I'm not the same person I was 6 months ago or a year ago or 5 years ago. And so to steadily ask myself, like, what can I do for me now? And so a part of me traveling, I mean, I live in a van right now and I'm just traveling around. I've driven, I think, 11,000 miles or something in the last 12 weeks. And, you know, was that a bucket list item? It wasn't. But when I was tuning into myself, it's what my spirit needed. And one of the things I realized was that if I don't feed myself, then I am not available for others or everyone. And goodness, what I do know is that when I do feed myself, what I can give is significant. And so that's been a big learning part for me is what that looks like.
Yeah, that's hard because I can imagine everybody starting your own company. Everybody says you got to work. And then what happens to the person who started the whole thing? They're like a little shell at the end. So that's a really unique and special message, Katie. And I'm curious about this. So it sounds like now you work around people you love, and maybe before, like so many of us do, you work with people you don't love as much. But during the hard times, was there ever a lure or an attraction to go back to working for somebody so that all the responsibility wasn't on you?
You know, I have random thoughts of like, I could go work at a barista cafe for a couple of weeks just because the, you know, I don't know. There's something about like somebody comes in, maybe there's regulars. We've been remote since day one. So that was something that wasn't new to us in 2020. And I would say that the downfall for that with me in particular is that I do love that daily interaction of people to people. Mm-hmm. The thing I've done, so this year with COVID, for example, I was feeling that pressure that you're speaking of, which is just, I had 50 employees. It's like, yeah. And I felt like I was sitting here making the decision for these 50 people and was having a very difficult time with it. And I was sitting at home and it just dawned on me that I have created an extremely transparent working environment, which for me was always very important. And I trust the people that are in the company. And why was I when I could make it as a group? So I called a company-wide meeting in person and we all stood there and I said every potential kind of same thought, now that I think about it, same thought process I had of starting the company of like what I could see with all of this unknown, here's our options. And then I let the group decide. I just let everybody decide, and it wasn't just on me. And so I've actually turned toward that method more in the last year and a half than I have any prior years, which is me being the person that makes all of these decisions versus, hey, how about we all just make it together? Because that feels, I mean, for me, if we make a decision, I feel as if it's stronger and more people are bought in because it's made by everyone. And who am I to know somebody else's life? I mean, I had a phone call come in. So who am I to know about these people? I mean, I only know them from a work experience to some degree.
Sure. Well, you know, Katie's on her van. She's getting calls. You know, she's got this whole life experience. I'm curious, logistically, how does this work? It sounds like, I mean, you've traveled the world. It's not like you just went to New Mexico this one time. You travel all the time. So logistically, for someone who's thinking, ah, that's what I want. I want the business where I travel the world and run the business. How do you do that? And did you do that from the offset, or is that a newer thing?
From the get-go, I've pretty much been this way. I mean, it's the people. I'd say it's the people. Somebody's like, well, who's managing the company while you're traveling? I'm like, it doesn't need to be managed. Like, I work with people who don't need to be managed. It seems like the fastest, easiest route. I mean, for me, if somebody needs to be managed, then I don't know. We're probably not a good fit for one another. And then the second key for me was providing clear structure that people can put into. So if anything, I built a tech system that runs and operates the entire company from A to Z, that everybody has access to certain parts. So anybody can access any piece of information necessary for them to do their job at any point in time, eliminating the need to pick up the phone and call you and say, hey, did you put in so-and-so? I just go into the system, I find the number. That way, if somebody needs to take their kid to the doctor, that's totally fine. And because they plan on staying up till midnight to do their work. Well, they can, and they don't have to worry about midnight because so-and-so is asleep. Because so-and-so doing their job, put it into the system, they go in there and access it. So I'd say clarity of and transparency of information is super key. And then that coupled with solid people.
Yeah. Okay. You got this is going to make everybody say, I don't want to be an entrepreneur. I just want to work for Katie. Like, I just want to work for Katie. For this business. That's great. It's a great to see the different mindsets and hear how different people manage their different companies. Cause it just shows that it's your company. You can manage it how you wish. I would love to hear what is next for you and for your businesses.
That's a good question. You know, it's so funny because January, February, we had certain goals and we were at certain employees, and then, you know, 2020 came around. So 2020 was a trimming. It was a giant trim. I can say that. And as we're going back into units, so I work in the apartment industry. Entering units was not even a possibility. We were going into 100 homes a day. So when this happened, going into homes was not even an option. And so we couldn't work for 3 months, 3 solid months, we could not work. Fortunately for me, I'm a very conservative fiscal person, and so are the people that I work with. So we are a debt-free company. We bootstrapped from the get-go. We don't have any investors. So something like 2020 happened and we didn't work. I didn't have this leverage that I was trying to chase. We all sort of looked at each other and thought, well, 3 month break, vacation, everybody goes on vacation.
Oh shoot, it sounds like Kate put out. Is she back? Let me know if you guys can hear me. I can hear you now. Finish that thought.
Am I back now? Okay.
Yeah.
So not at the same speed or capacity at the beginning of the year. So when you ask where are we now and where are we headed, I would say that we're still timidly stepping, similar to the rest of the world, trying to see what these next several months are going to be like. Do I see Save Water Co. doing her thing into the future. Of course. I mean, she's a great, we recycle. I mean, it's such a good deal. I mean, it's, she's just, we always are approaching the mindset of like, how can everyone and everything win, including the environment? So I say that the environment has a seat at our table, but our clients love money. Well, I'll just make them money. And our very byproduct of our company is saving all this water from the earth. So it's, we're like a for-profit company with nonprofit values. And that's a really fun place to be.
Killer.
Super. So for me, what's our future look like? I just keep, I mean, wait out these next couple of months, just kind of see how the next year goes. And I mean, she'll steadily build momentum and keep doing her thing, I'm pretty sure.
Yeah. Well, it sounds like it. And it sounds like you are doing your thing. Where are you traveling next?
I have no plans after Taos. So I'm probably going to just, what I've done multiple times is just cranked the van and I get to like a stop and I'm like, do I go east or do I go west? And I just kind of decide in the moment and then I just start driving and see where I land. So I don't know.
Well, it's really fun to see a spontaneous person like you. It sounds like, I mean, I don't know you. I've known you for 20 minutes. But it's neat to see somebody who's not as you know, we talked earlier at the beginning, you know, Sana is, she does her time blocking and she does her scheduling and, you know, in UK, you're more free flowing. So it's just nice to see all these different examples of women who have created something beautiful in their own unique way.
Yeah, I no routines over here. I was a routine person, but every day, I don't know.
Well, this has been great. I've so enjoyed your words of wisdom, Katie. And ladies, I know you've been kind of like waiting to jump in and ask your questions. So I don't want to hog all the questions. So we will leap right into the Q&A portion of the show. This feels like a show. We'll welcome Mandy back in.
And hi.
Your questions. Hey, ladies.
Hi.
Okay. I'm scrolling up in the chat. Yes, you're back. I'm scrolling up in the chat. And of course, those of us on the chat have been sort of like, I've been seeing some chats back and forth. So I want to go back and forth and figure out who the audience wrote in for. Because I was able to ask some of my burning questions, although I have so many more too. But we'll get to the audience questions first. And we will start with Sana. Oh, this is a good question. On the scarves, how did you choose your colors? How did you decide which color scheme to go with?
Mm-hmm. So the first collection that we launched, we called the pastel collection. So it contained yellow, blue, purple, and pink. And the exact shades that we used, we based all of those hijabs on color theory. We wanted people to feel really good about themselves. The colors that we picked reflect like energizing moods, boosting self-esteem, calming, relaxing, because they're colors that you won't really find for hijabs. Like hijabs traditionally are kind of a little bit more on the boring side. And we kind of wanted to do the opposite and make them really fun, bright, vibrant. So that's how we started off our collection.
Yeah, it sounds like you did it. I mean, they're beautiful. That you guys have got to follow. Shout out your Instagram page really quick.
It's just Lala Hijabs. You'll find us on all platforms under Lala Hijabs.
It's just like, it's one of those where, careful, you better time block this because you'll get lost just like scrolling through her feed because it's so pretty.
Thank you.
I'll be on for TikTok, but spend a little bit of time. It's really, really fun. Okay, this is a question from Elaine asking for you, Mandy. What was, and we got into this a little bit, but I think they're looking for a specific moment. What was the moment that birthed your company concept?
Like I said, there's been many incidences, but I can't point to one incident. The biggest thing that I can point to is although I've had a son, I had a daughter, and I think I was starting to be much more reflective of the world and what kind of world I wanted them to enter into. And, you know, when I was more junior and different things happened at work, I can kind of discount it to, well, I'm junior. But then when I was a partner and I still was having issues, I felt that I needed to do something about it. I felt that so much of what I heard from a lot of programs were based off of individual interventions or based off of saying, well, let me teach you, you know, I'm going to mentor you or sponsor you, which are important, but still didn't get to the heart of the issue of, we know that there's something structurally wrong with our systems, that talent doesn't reside in just one gender or race or demographic group. So if there's only certain talent going to the C-suite, and we know it, right? Right now, there are the highest number of women CEOs that there's ever been. There's 38. There's 38 women CEOs in the Fortune 500. And that's the most we've ever had. There's more men named John in the Fortune 500 than women CEOs. So we know that there's something wrong with the systems. And so I did not want to, you know, teach my daughter what I thought are survival skills, right? As far as this is the way to navigate these systems, that if we know the systems are broken, our focus needs to be on actually fixing the systems.
Okay. Yeah. Yeah. We just did an interview actually on our station yesterday about, and I want to say she said there were either only three or four black CEOs of all the Fortune 500 companies. I mean, it's like, yeah. How is this happening? So that's a great answer. Katie, for you, what is your, for a college student who's watching right now, is like, I've got this crazy idea. I think I want to change the, apartment water crisis or you know, whatever it is. What's your best piece of advice for them to just get started?
Please. I'll tell a quick story. So it would be, I signed my first contract and I was like, oh, I need a vendor. So then I just look in the deal and I'm like, okay, here, this looks like a plumbing wholesale vendor. So I just go there, I set up an account. On the phone, I start making an order and they're like, do you have a PO? I go, 1 second, please. Pause the phone, Google PO, because I had no idea what it meant. I was like, oh, purchase order. Get back on the phone. And then I wrote, do I need one of those? And then Google was like, no, not necessarily. So I get back on the phone. I was like, oh, no PO is necessary. Just go ahead and ship it to XYZ. So I bring that story up because I have flown by the seat of my pants to some degree throughout the building of this entire company. And I think the biggest fear and insecurity a person might have, which in my experience has not been the case, is that we will not be provided for. So what I have learned is that if that idea or that impulse is driving me, it may be the last nanosecond, but something will show up. And our lessons always spread themselves out. So we didn't on the first apartment complex that we worked on get all of our lessons and it just be a storm. We got one or two major ones. And then we get to the next apartment complex and one or two major ones would show up again. And we get to the next one and one or two major ones would show up again. And what I saw was like, it's like life is somewhat spreading my lessons along so that I have enough air at the time to learn them and then keep going. And so for me, to a person who's got an idea, I mean, it's just go for it. You cannot, there's no way to be prepared. And if your life lands you a similar journey, your lessons will come spread out in just enough time to where like you don't, like on the days where I'm crying, like no more lessons came in that day. So then the next day I was like, oh, I slept and like, oh, okay, I'm ready for a new lesson and had enough life in it for it. So.
Oh, that's a great message. You just kind of take those lessons, learn, cry. Or not, and move on. Yeah, that's.
Oh,
great.
I've had many times of crying in the past 6 years, for sure.
I think that makes the rest of us feel a little bit better. Okay, Sana, a question for you about selling online. About during this time, some people, even if they have an established business, they weren't selling online; they were selling to people in person. And so, what are your tips for people who are really trying to get a product out there to the world and do so online exclusively?
Mm-hmm. I think the biggest thing is showing people the value behind your product and what makes it different than other people's. Hype it up. And like, for instance, if you're going to be launching a new product, we always make sure that we take about 2 weeks or even 3 weeks to hype up that specific product ahead of time. So you gain a whole bunch of people on your email list. You kind of pitch it to them a little bit, give them little like sneak peeks. And people really like the FOMO factor, like the fear of missing out. That's really, really big. So if you can do that, that is honestly like the best way to sell online.
That's great. That's a really, really good advice. And thank you for being open and honest about that. Mm-hmm. Okay, question from Sherry to Mandy. How do you incorporate mental health and wellness into the program you deliver?
Yeah, so when we are working with organizations, we look at things from an intersectionality lens. So neurodiversity is one of the things that we really bring a lot of awareness to with companies and do a lot of our assessments from a diversity, equity, inclusion standpoint. And so we think it's important to holistically look at your employees and the challenges and experiences they may be experiencing in the workplace. And so that is one of the issues that we look at. During the pandemic, right, we've seen mental health awareness be heightened, right? There's extreme burnout. People don't have the foundational and support systems that were traditionally in place. And so we've tried to really lean into mental health and well-being awareness and ensure that companies are creating those support systems to support their employees. These are not normal times. And so we tell companies, let's not act like it's normal. We think that that is to the detriment of your team, that we need to be giving people extra days for mental health and well-being to ensure we do not have that burnout that we're seeing kind of running rampant right now in the workplace.
Yeah. Are you in media companies? Are you doing these surveys, media companies?
We can connect after this, Jenny.
I love what you're doing. Okay, Elaine has the same question that I had, Katie, and I'm so glad that she asked this. What does a regular work week look like for you? And I have a feeling you're going to say they're all different, but like, give us an example.
Now, while I'm in the van life, I'm not working. So I'll go back to before sure. van world. No meetings or calls before 9:30. Just not available. Just absolutely not available at all. Oftentimes I'd push it to 10. So just no. Usually I'm available from like 10 to noon. And then from 2 to 4. And then beyond that though, I'm probably not available. I rarely do more than one like meeting a day, especially if it's in person. And yeah, I did in the beginning, I pushed myself through just a lot. I did a lot. And I, again, a part of my journey has been like, no. Like I'm not here to expense myself. And I told myself that a lot in the very beginning. And I gave myself all these reasons for doing it. You know, water conservation is necessary. The planet needs it. My people need it. And I was joking with somebody on this trip. I was playing golf with them. And he said, so exactly what are you? And I was like, you know, I learned how to become unimportant. And that has been a big part of me, of my journey, is if I realized that a part of me was I valued me personally to being needed and wanted. If my phone wasn't ringing, then who am I? And so what I said was that I hit the retirement life crisis at the age of 35. And what I mean by that is that my whole life was focused and then that was removed. And then all of a sudden, who am I as a being without that? And it was cool to be able to journey through all of that because now I'm coming out of it asking, what does work look like for me? And if I were to emphasize my creativity and sort of get rid of any definitions of a CEO or what an owner of a company should look like, be like, work like, if I got rid of all of that, then what does my work life look like? And could it be completely different and that have nothing to do with the direct impact of success? What if the company will actually be more successful if I do it this way?
Right. That's interesting because it is so true when it comes to defining who we are, like people, you know, oh, hi, I'm so-and-so and I do this. I am this, I am this, I am this. And it sounds like you were able to take your company and build this and then also create Katie as a separate entity who has likes and interests and passions outside of earning an income.
Well, so even when I look at the current definition of a CEO, I'm like, I don't even like half of what that says. I don't even like that's not even me. So then I was like, oh no. I'm not a CEO. I can't be a CEO. I need to hire a CEO. And then I just started questioning like any of that. Just, and somebody's like, how are you doing van life with people? Like who's, I'm like, I have great people. I just pretty much try to throw out as many definitions that are given to me as possible and then just internally create them with my team. And we just do our thing.
I think that's great. It's just a great message in attracting the right type of people to your company too. And it sounds like that's what you've done, is you've attracted that right type of person, which it sounds like it's sustaining what you're doing. Let's talk about networking. Gina had a question about networking, and I think we've got time to let everybody give a quick answer on this. And I will start with you, Mandy. We talked earlier on when people were on for that discussion about those right connections and relationships. So, and also the difficulty of getting funding, et cetera. So what do you suggest to young entrepreneurs in terms of networking and getting your name out there and really, you know, staking a claim for your company?
I cannot stress enough how important it is. You know, not only is it important in terms of connections as far as with funding, I think most people may know, and if they're not, I can give a short description. Unfortunately, the reason why we see so many disparities within funding for women and for people of color is because VCs operate by warm introductions. And so you have to have someone make a connection for you to the venture capitalist. They don't have their emails or information on their websites. And so you have to be able to get into that network. And so that's why we see some of the funds that are focused on women or underrepresented founders actually put their email addresses on their website, right? And say, please send me your pitch deck. Please send me your business idea, because it shouldn't be a closed community where only people that know the folks within the venture capital community are able to get their businesses funded. So I'd say not only is it important on the funding front, but when we think of some of our first investors who were maybe angels, were people that practiced law with me, you know, that were fellow partners that I had established those relationships with. When we think about some of the customers that we've been able to have onto the platform, we were able to get some of those first key, especially when we think about the individuals that helped us beta test our platform and test out the technology, were folks that I had met somewhere along the way in my career somewhere, maybe served on a nonprofit board with them. So I think it's very, very important for people to establish those relationships, because when you're first starting your business out, people are relying on their own experiences with you. And, you know, it's key and critical to not only use it from that funding perspective, but same thing with our advisory board. You know, a lot of the introductions we were able to make with our advisory board was from connections that I either had somewhere in my life. It might have been college, law school, somewhere within the 12 years where I was practicing law. But that's how everything within the business was really able to come together, was through those connections.
Yeah, it sounds like it worked for you, Mandy. Thank you for hitting home the importance of that. Okay, Sana, I wonder if your experience is similar or different, given your, you know, more specific online presence. Talk about networking as it relates to you and your business.
Mm-hmm. So I'm a huge believer in like the know, like, and trust factor in terms of having a business online. Us personally, I feel like we've branded our business in such a different way because we really have put a face to our business, and everybody knows us by name. So even when they're purchasing a product, in the comment section under the notes, they'll say, thank you, Will and Sana, for this order. It's really personal, and people really know that we're literally just two people running this business. So for us, I feel like we really connect with everybody that we can. We answer almost every single comment on social media. We answer every single DM. We try to be as personal as possible. We take time out every single day to just sit down on our phones, scroll everything, and make sure we respond to every single person. And I think that's really made a big difference for us.
That's amazing. So that's the 2020 version of networking, is responding to DMs. Mm-hmm. You know, what's interesting is I think you'd be surprised, you guys, at how far ahead that will get you. We reach out to people even for media interviews, sometimes via DM, and it's a business or a leader and they're not even checking. And I'm thinking, what a missed opportunity. So that's actually really impressive, considering your following, that you're responding or, you know, making it to respond to all those people. So the 2020 version of networking. All right, Katie, what about you? How did you attract all these wonderful employees and make all of these relationships?
So I actually didn't even hire a salesperson for like 4 years in or something. We went off of referral. So the things I would say mostly is always do what you say, always. And we always deliver. Like, that is everything. And if I I'm super transparent with my clients, my vendors, my employees. And I think that that's absolutely key. And I almost feel like that transparency makes its way throughout people. So then that's how more employees come. That's how more clients come. And I would also tell somebody to ask for the referral, ask for it. So even if you're like, I feel super awkward right now and I just met this person and I'm not quite sure, ask for it right then and there. I mean, just get comfortable with being uncomfortable. And this person might go, I can't believe you just asked me for a referral. Well, listen, you have to ask yourself, what do you want more? This person's likability of you or what you're set out to do? And I would say that that has gotten me quite far, is being willing to be uncomfortable and just ask no matter what. So that's what I would encourage somebody to do.
That's a beautiful way to finish, just because I think what a perfectly diverse panel in the way that you shared different experiences and just different forms of networking. Because man, when I started out in the business, you know, networking was very different than it is right now. Now it's like respond to that DM. So thank you so much. Katie Anderson, Sana Salah, Mandy Price, you all are a massive inspiration. And it's just been a huge joy for me to be able to speak with you today. Thank you to all the guests. I wish I could see you in person, but I hope that at least the online platform allowed more people the opportunity to sit down, engage, you know, drum up some motivation here in the middle of the week. Please know that the Women's Summit will be open tomorrow as well. And you guys, like, this is going to be a huge day. It's closing tomorrow with the final keynote from the Netflix show, Emily, from Emily's Wonder Lab. We look forward to seeing you there. I won't be on screen, but I will be behind the scenes checking it out. And thank you again so much, everybody, being here. I want to make sure I don't have any other notes from UT Dallas about what to say. Nope, I think we're good. I think we're wonderfully set up to go out and rock the rest of the week. Thanks, everybody. Bye-bye. Thank you.